We talked at the start about the way internet and technology have democratized our access to all of these sorts of people and resources and information, and how that's created opportunities in almost every industry. And there's really nobody that's done that better in this country anyway than our next speaker. As a guy that moved over here as a young boy with migrant parents, grew up in the Commission Flats down in Elstonwick, and I think on the BRW list that's just come out this morning, has built himself up to a value of over $300 million at the tender age of 31. Our next speaker really does need no intro, but I'll give him one anyway. In a recent interview, I heard Ruslan describe wealth and the figures that get thrown around about how much people are worth as not an indication of the things that you can buy, but as an indication of the value that you've created. And with that in mind, there's really no question that Ruslan Kogan is the undisputed king of online retail in Australia. And I'd like to bring him up to tell us his story and how he did it.
Well, it all started in my parents' garage. I had no money at all, and I started an online business, Kogan.com.au.
But Ruslan Kogan is making enemies with the big retailers.
The more competition there is, the consumer's going to benefit.
They're a whole lot cheaper.
The LED TV price war has started, and we're ready.
He's built his business empire online. He joins us now, Ruslan.
Gen Y, what do you think?
I think that the way that we communicate is changing.
A customer's going to go for it.
The whole Kogan business is all about giving customers exactly what they want.
How is it that you're able to undercut your competitors by so much?
Virgin Galactic sending people out into space. It's a business that I respect, and it's what Kogan does. It's innovating in a new marketplace.
Thank you. BRW went out of business after they published that front cover. One thing Dan forgot to mention in the startup story, or the intro, is my first ever office was actually donated to me by Dan and Juz from Hard Hat. I had the little spare room next to them, and Juz would teach me how to do stuff in Photoshop. I was selling a few t-shirts and stuff on the side at the time, and Dan was the model. True story. We've all moved on from there a little bit. Well, that was an incredible couple of speakers. Well done, Justine. That was awesome in terms of how to use technology to get the right attention from the right people. When Kogan was really small and we wanted to get the attention of certain suppliers and other business partners, we used to jump on Google and buy their name in AdWords and then run an ad there. And, you know, whilst no one will admit it, everyone Googles their own name. And, you know, within a matter of weeks, you'd get them to contact you. So we thought that was pretty good. But that just took things to a whole new level. And it was good to hear Brendan's talk as well in terms of all of the information that organizations have and the correct perspective being that we're actually getting a lot more value out of it than we're giving up. The fact that Facebook looks completely different to everyone is the reason why it's one of the most popular sites in the world. And at Kogan, we take that stuff very seriously. And I often joke that we're a statistics business masquerading as a retailer. No matter what senior position you want at Kogan, a data analytics test in your job interview is one of the primary requirements. So I'm going to talk today a bit about the Kogan startup story on the whole theme of how the internet has shattered boundaries and barriers to entry in almost every single industry. And one thing that it's done is that it's ensured that it's easier than ever to start a business. It's easier than ever for anyone to communicate with their end consumer. And whereas traditionally big businesses kept getting bigger and bigger just from being big, you know, the ability to leverage on loans and from the banks and all of that sort of stuff, now intellectual property is just as important as any physical property. And we live in a business environment that it's the person with the best ideas and ability to implement them that's going to win, rather than the people with the deepest pockets. And that's a great thing for everyone. Now, in the essence of profiling and getting as much information about your users as possible so you can tailor a better experience for them, I just want to get a bit of a understanding of the crowd. How many people in here run their own business? Can you put your hand up? And how many people work for an agency? And how many work in any other different type of business? Not an agency, but a different suite. How many people were born in Australia? Right, and whose parents were born in Australia? A lot less people, all right. And who's heard of Kogan? Sweet. Don't need to fire any marketing managers because the whole Fair Work Australia thing's a head fuck, so that was good. When I used to tell the Kogan startup story, it started in 2006. That's when I registered the business and got the company name. And a couple of years ago, I realized that it started much earlier than that, and the inspiration for it started much earlier than 2006. I made it to an Entrepreneur of the Year awards night, and it was one of those, I was one of the finalists, and it was one of those gala swanky dinner things with lots of knives and forks, and you didn't know which one to use, and one of those type of events. And there was a plaque in the middle of the table, and it had all the finalists listed. And I looked at the plaque, and all of the finalist names were Russian. And at that point, I thought, oh shit, I didn't bribe any of the judges. I'm definitely not going to win this one. So then the event went on. They must have counted the bribes wrong, and I somehow ended up winning it. I get up on stage, and I point out to the MC, when he was interviewing me, that all of the finalists were Russian. And he said, well, why do you think that is? I had no idea. I said, I don't know, maybe vodka's got something to do with it. And then he went on to question me about business and asked me how much of my business skills I got from my parents. And I told him that, my parents didn't teach me anything or anything business related. And, we grew up in communist Russia. So, or communist Soviet Union. There's no such thing as business skills in a communist country. Like, my parents, they're really good at mathematics, but not at business skills. So my mum wouldn't understand simple principles like supply, demand, economies of scale, opportunity cost. So, for instance, we were in the housing commission flats in Elsternwick growing up, and there was a Coles, very close by. But my mum would drive to Dandenong to buy fruit and veg. And I'd be like, Mum, why are you driving to Dandenong? She's like, oh, it's cheaper there. It takes her nearly an hour to get there, money spent on petrol, nearly an hour to get back, money spent on petrol. And I'd be like, Mum, it's actually not cheaper. It's cheaper for you to get fruit and veg from Coles up the top of the street rather than going Dandenong, because you're better off just working an hour extra at work and it works out cheaper. But she wouldn't get it. She'd come back from a sale and, have a dress that cost $150 and she bought it for $50, and she'd come home and go, oh, look, I saved $100. Like, did you save $100 or did you waste $50? Probably not a popular comment with the ladies. But I tried to explain to Mum that the price of something is only the level at which a transaction occurs. That just because a store was selling it for $150 doesn't mean it's worth $150. No store randomly decides, oh, these dresses are selling so well at $150, we're just going to drop the price to $50. That doesn't happen. The price of something's the value, the level at which a transaction occurs. So I try and explain these things to Mum, but couldn't. So no, my parents didn't teach me any business lessons, and I explained that to the MC. Then I got off stage and an elderly gentleman came up to me and he said, you know what? You got a lot more business skills from your parents than you know. And I said, well, how so? And he said, think about what it takes to be an immigrant. You've got to drop everything you've got, take a massive risk, travel into the unknown, and work your ass off for a potential benefit that might not even be there. Think about what it takes to be an entrepreneur. You've got to drop everything you've got, take a massive risk, travel into the unknown, work your ass off for a potential benefit that might not even be there. And I thought, oh wow, never thought of it that way. And I did grow up watching my parents land in Australia with $90 in their pocket, work three or four jobs each, raise kids at the same time. Mum would go from working in one cafe to being a cleaner at another. Dad would deliver pizzas, then help someone out at the Vic Market, then deliver pamphlets, come home, study English, raise kids at the same time. You know, I grew up watching my parents do that and take the massive risk to come to a new country where they didn't know anything about, didn't know the language, and all of that. And I thought, well, watching them do this has definitely made a massive contribution to how I am today. And watching them take those risks and work their butt off have been key skills in running a business and starting Kogan. So now when I tell the story, it started in 1989 rather than 2006. Let's fast forward a few years to 2003. So I was at Monash Uni doing a Bachelor of BS, Business Systems. And I was on some sort of scholarship that allowed me to go do a semester of abroad at University of Miami, whilst at the same time swapping real IT subjects for golf, scuba diving, tennis, and can't remember what else. So I got to go to Miami, which was a sweet deal because the University of Miami is one of the best colleges there. It's like $40,000 a semester. So I was on whatever hex here is to go to a $40,000 a semester college while some poor kid from Miami was paying $40,000 to go to Monash. So I was getting a sweet deal. I arrive at the University of Miami, and we knew in order to have a successful semester, we're going to need some mini bar fridges for our dorm rooms. So all of the international kids get together, and all we'd heard about at uni was Walmart, 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 Walmart. Economies of scale, latest and greatest, best marketing, optimized supply chain, best prices. So we knew we need to go to Walmart to buy our mini bar fridge. We gather, we catch the train and the bus to the Walmart, we get our mini bar fridges, we schlep them back to the dorm rooms, bus, train again. It was a full day excursion, but at least we got our mini bar fridges, and at the end of the day we had a hard-earned thirst and somewhere to keep our beer cold. So mission accomplished. Until we were pretty pissed off the next day when we saw the American kids and they had FedEx drivers just wheeling their mini bar fridge to their dorm room. And we thought, ah, rich kids. And then we speak to the American kids and they paid half the price that we did and got to chill by the pool the whole previous day. And I thought, okay, that's a pretty decent idea. And then I realized that a small online retailer can operate with greater efficiency than a Goliath like Walmart. So I kept that thought in the back of my head and went on with a semester of studying in Miami, went and traveled Europe for a bit, got back to Australia. When I got back, I'd already, finished my degree, and I had a pretty unique skill set at the time that I did on top of my uni degree called a CCIE, Cisco Certified Internet Working Engineer, meaning I could connect routers and switches and computer networks and stuff. So I got, as a 21-year-old at the time, I got a pretty sweet gig on $150,000 a year at GE as a network administrator. So I was working there doing that, and it was starting to bore me because I knew the stuff back to front and it wasn't challenging on a daily basis, and it was the same old grind. I wasn't jumping out of bed in the morning. Then Accenture started to market to me to try and poach me to go work at Accenture. Is there anyone here from Accenture? Has anyone in the past worked at Accenture? Well, we've got one. Sweet. You'll enjoy this. So Accenture starts sending me these brochures showing people on laptops in parks. And I would look at them and think, that is so awesome. I want to be one of these consultant guys working in a park on a laptop. That's so cool. That's exactly what I want to do. And the only problem was, I was on 150K a year. Accenture was about 45K a year. So everyone I spoke to saying, yeah, I'm going to quit GE, go work at Accenture in a park on a laptop, told me I was crazy to take such a massive pay cut. But GE was boring me and I wasn't happy and I really wanted to work in a park on a laptop. I quit GE and went to work for Accenture. It was the worst place ever. I did not spend a single day in a park on a laptop. Accenture is the McDonald's of smart people. Everything there is process driven. When they were trying to poach me and recruit me, they were all like, oh, innovative workplace, coming up with new ideas, you know, Tiger Woods in the ads, and like, you know, all these people with thinking clouds and all this like cool stuff going on. And I'm like, awesome, innovative workplace, new ideas, this is so great. You get there, go put on a project, here is the process. Step one, step two, step 2A, B, C, step three, step four, step five. They tell you what to do all the way through. And I thought, well, how are we meant to innovate if there's a definitive process for everything? And I spoke to my manager about it and said, well, yeah, I'm struggling to figure this out. How do we innovate? They said, well, you know, the innovative and creative bit comes through how you follow the process. I never really understood that concept. So, like, just to put in perspective, this organization has a diagram in the bathrooms showing you how to go to the toilet. No shit. It's a step-by-step guide telling you what to do and what not to do. To make you feel worse about that, well, you probably don't feel bad about it at all at the moment. I'm the one who had to endure it. But to make you feel worse, your taxpayer dollars are paying for it. It's produced by the Victorian government and you can find it on their website. Apparently, different people from different cultures do it differently. I thought it was a pretty straightforward user experience on how you meant to interact with that thing. So I wasn't enjoying Accenture very much. And then I got put on a project that made me enjoy it even less. Got sent to work in Newcastle on a big project for an aluminium company. I probably just gave away exactly who it is. So I arrived there. There's about 10 grads on the project. We're migrating data from one system to another. And there's about 100,000 records that need migration. They break it up into 10,000 lines per person, and they gave it to each of the 10 grads. They give it to us on a 9 a.m. on a Monday morning, and they say you've got to finish it by Friday. There's a week's worth of work there. And they expected us to do it manually. Now, I looked at it and saw a few patterns in the data, wrote a script, converted the data. By 9:30 a.m. that Monday, I went to my manager and I said, look, I finished the task. There's no reason to spend a whole week on it for all of our, for our whole team. I can show all the other guys how to do it, and we can move on to the next thing. Here's my completed work. And my manager said to me, she was like, no, there's no chance you could have done it properly. There's at least a week worth of work here. You couldn't have done this properly. Go and do it again and, you know, do it properly. And I was like, no, I've double checked it. I have done it properly. Please have a look at it. She refused to even have a look at it. And, you know, that was pretty demoralizing for me. So, you know, put my head down, walked back to my computer. Good news is I was doing a few things on eBay on the side at this time. So I got to spend, I thought, you know, 5 days on eBay, sweet. Now, I know quite a few of you put your hand up for coming from the agency world. You guys are probably thinking at the moment, oh, she's an awesome manager. Because now I sort of understand that thing, because I once had a mate who worked in a law firm in the city, and I come to meet him for lunch and he's like, oh, I'm just dropping some documents off. I'm delivering documents to another company. I'm like, really? You did 6 years of uni for that? And he's like, well, you can't charge a courier out at $500 an hour. So all right, fair enough. So I'm guessing the manager at Accenture did a good thing, because we were getting paid fuck all and she's charging us out at $300 an hour. She's not interested in a quicker way to complete that task. You know, she's like, even if she believed that I had finished it, there's no incentive for her to accept what I had done. So that was pretty demoralizing. At roughly the same time, I was, you know, I've always been into gadgets and stuff. The kid in high school who always had the latest phone would buy one, sell another, buy the next, always buying gadgets. And flat screen TVs were the big thing at the time. So, you know, they were just coming into the market and I wanted a new flat screen TV. So I went around shopping for one, and even though I was earning some decent coin, when I went to the big stores, I realized I couldn't afford one. So I thought, all right, I still want one. What am I going to do? And then I got an idea. So I went onto Google, found big factories over in China who manufacture these things, and started emailing them saying, you know, hi, I'd like to order 100,000 TVs. Please send me a quote. And my goal at the time was that, you know, once they reply with their quotes, I'll be like, oh, can you send me a sample? And that was going to be my TV. Sweet. But they start replying and I start noticing a few interesting things. That even though there's thousands of TV brands out there, there's only four major panel manufacturers who make big LCD panels. Samsung, Hitachi, LG and Sharp. So no matter what brand you buy, the panel, the core technology, the component that makes up over 80% of the TV is made by one of those four brands. So even if you went and bought a Sony TV, it would be using a Sharp panel. If you bought a Bang & Olufsen TV, it would be using a Samsung panel. So I realized that in this industry, it's all pretty much same shit, different smell. And then I started seeing the prices that they're sending through, and I could land a TV for $1,000 in Australia that at that time was costing $3,000 or $4,000 in the big stores. Then I remembered back to the Miami days, a bit hazy, but I still got there, and thought, hang on a second, this is a perfect online business model. Because online retail is all about selling products at a maximum value per cubic centimeter. I can't sell water tanks online because by the time I ship one from Melbourne to Perth, it's going to cost 10 times more than the water tank. It's very expensive to ship air. But when you have a TV, which is a nice thin little box with a $1,000 product in it, it's a beautiful product for online retail. So I thought, well, this is a specs-based product. You can easily sell this online by putting two specs side by side. People can be easily incentivized by a better price. I should do this. So I went and spoke to a few business leaders. And the business leaders were like, you're crazy, online retail is for books and CDs, because all they knew of at that time was Amazon. I went and spoke to a few mates and they also said I'm crazy, because they said that people are not going to buy a TV without seeing it first. And I was like, no, I think they will. If they see the specs are the same, if they get to read a few user reviews, I think people, you know, will take that risk initially for a big saving. And so everyone was against it. I went and spoke to my mom and told her I'm going to quit Accenture and I'm going to start this business. And she started crying. She was like, you've got a great education, a job, and now you want to be a TV salesman? And I was like, no, mom, it's not quite TV salesman. But yeah, she didn't get it. But I still decided to do it. So, you know, I take calculated risks. So I wanted to be as risk averse as possible. So I came into Accenture, this was on a Wednesday, and I took my manager aside and I said, look, I want to take 1 year leave without pay because I'm going through a few personal issues at the moment. I thought, if it doesn't work out, I still want to be able to come back. And she was like, oh, look, we don't do leave without pay, blah, blah, blah. You know, you've barely been here a year. No, 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 no. And I said, look, in that case, I want to resign. And I resigned. And I know my contract states 28 days notice. I've never broken an agreement in my life. And I will work the 28 days that the notice period requires. However, if there's anything I can do to shorten that period, I'm happy to work whatever hours you want. I'll work 20 hours a day. I'll work weekends. I'll do all of the handover. Tell me what you need done. I want to shorten that 28-day period. And she said to me, she was like, oh, look, don't worry about it. Just finish up today. And I knew I wasn't really appreciated at Accenture, but I had no idea to what extent. So I went, emptied my drawers and went home. On that Wednesday, started building the website. By Sunday, Kogan was up and running. The website was ready, the products were listed, or well, pretty much up and running. I'll get to it. So products were listed, website is ready, everything's looking really good. So the business is ready to go, except for one slight problem, that I didn't have any money. And the way that China works is you need to pay them for TVs. They don't just send them to you. So I thought, uh-oh, this isn't good because I need to work something out. And business leaders have already told me that I'm crazy and they're not interested in this idea. And I was thinking about what I'm going to do. But then my mum needed me to go help her haggle on a new dining room table that she wanted. So I went with her to the furniture store. She showed me the table she wanted. I haggled with the salesman a bit. I got her a much better price for it. We went to the counter and the guy was like, oh, you know, that'll be $5,000. My mum took out a credit card, gave it to him. He swiped it, she signed for it. And then he said, oh, Mrs. Kogan, you will love this table. You'll have it within 45 to 60 days. I thought, all right. If that's just how it works, and that's just how it works. So I went back to the website, and for all of the TVs, I knew they take about 25 days to manufacture, 15 days shipping time, and 5 days slack time. So I said, we'll be delivered in 45 days on all of the TVs, and made them go live. I then set up Google AdWords campaigns, and that started driving traffic immediately. I set up a 1-300 number on the website, and that worked really well as well, because people think if you've got a 1-300 number, you're massive. They don't realize that it's like $14 a month. And it was diverting to my mobile. That was the most expensive bit of it. And you know, all of a sudden, TVs are selling. People are weighing up the options, seeing $1,000 for a TV that costs $3,000 in store, and they're taking the punt. They're seeing the specs, they're liking it, generating traffic, the interwebs are talking about it. It's all going really well. I was also selling the TVs on eBay, and I did a unique thing where I did 1 cent no reserve auctions for the TVs. This enabled me to control exactly how many TVs I sell. It gave me the ability to control how many I needed to sell because there were certain deadlines that I needed to meet with China. So TVs were selling, but what 1 cent no reserve auctions were doing was amazing. And some people were like, oh my God, are you crazy? What if a TV sells for 5 cents? If you have a decent natural market out there, which the flat screen TV market is, and you have at least two people out there who want a product, it's always going to get the right price. So all of the TVs were ending for the right price. Like, no TV is going to end for 5 cents, because does that mean no one in Australia is willing to pay 10 cents for it? But what the 1 cent no reserve auctions were doing is generating a lot of attention. And people still kept asking, how can you do 1 cent no reserve auctions? And I tried to explain to them that, you know, when you see a house auction start for $500,000 and it ends for $673,000. If that auction started at $1, it would still end for $673,000. But because it started so low, it was getting way more views, way more watches, way more attention. The interwebs were talking about it. Everything was going great. And eBay became a really important sales channel because it already had millions of visitors, whereas the Kogan brand and website was nearly unknown at the time, or pretty actually unknown, except for the people that had called up and stuff. Like the beauty with having, like with the 1-300 number and the emails, like I'd answer the phone all the time with a different name. So thanks for calling Kogan, this is Tim. Thanks for calling Kogan, this is Russell. Thanks for calling Kogan, this is Bill. And on the emails, I'd always reply as a chick. So thanks for your inquiry, Lucy at Kogan. Oh, not a problem, we'll help you with that. Kindest regards, Sarah from Kogan. It's amazing, nobody ever complains to a chick. It got a bit awkward once where there was a guy who was like, oh, look, I don't need delivery. I'll pick it up from the warehouse and bring you flowers. I can't wait to meet you, Lucy. And then I created an out-of-office. Lucy's on annual leave email for him. But the amazing thing this is doing is anyone who hadn't heard of Kogan was like, wow, how have I not heard of these guys? Never seen this brand before. They're massive. I've dealt with 12 different people already. So everything was working well. And then I got a bit of money from the pre-sales and I was ready to place an order with China. So the factory that I'd chosen to work with and whose TVs I had listed on the site, I contacted them and I said, look, I've chosen to work with you. Thank you very much for the quote. I think you're the best factory to go with. But my order isn't going to be for 100,000 TVs. I want to do a trial order of 80 TVs. And they laughed at me and told me to piss off. China is all about mass production. It's all about setting up production lines and running production lines. The production line for a new model of TV would take about 2 days to set up. 80 TVs would take under 10 minutes to manufacture. It's not commercially viable for them to do it. And they explained that to me and pretty much told me to go away. So I was in a sticky situation now. Yes, I had the option of refunding everyone who'd bought a TV, but I was now unemployed and quit my job, and I'm thinking I need to find a way to make this work. How do I convince this factory to accept my order? They're not going to make any money off it. What else can I do? Now, anyone who's dealt with China before will know that even the biggest factories, these multi-billion dollar organizations, all of their marketing material is in Chinglish. None of it makes sense. All of their product brochures are in Chinglish. None of the images are aligned. User manuals aren't documented properly. They're missing diagrams. Diagrams aren't annotated. The pricing spreadsheets are all over the place. Like, they'll have numbers centered. I hate people who center numbers. Numbers are meant to be to the same number of decimal places, right justified. That's how you present numbers. So I thought, I know what I'm going to do. I'll redo all of this for them. So I stayed up for a couple of days and redid all of their marketing material. Made the product brochures look like a professional Western Accenture-style document. Made the headings consistent, translated all the Chinglish to English, made it look beautiful, borders, headings, footers, headers, right aligned all the numbers, bolded the headings, like everything looked really good, inserted diagrams into the user manuals, annotated the diagrams, did all of this. Then I sent it back to them and I said, hi, I understand there's no commercial value for you in the tiny order that I wish to place as my trial order, but there's other ways in which I can add value to this relationship. Please see attached what I have done. And I attached all of this stuff for them and sent off the email. A few hours later, I get a response back from them saying, thank you very much, Mr. Kogan. We really appreciate what you have done. We accept your order, and they gave me an even better price than we had previously negotiated. Sweet. Back on track, they're doing the order, smooth sailing. They emailed me a couple of weeks later saying they just want a massive customer in the US who said that they were by far the most professional factory they had encountered. So it created a win-win for both of us. And I got all the money that I received from selling TVs to that point, paid them the deposit for it, and it was smooth sailing. TVs are selling on the website, TVs were selling on eBay, and I was going to be able to pay the balance payment for the order just in time for when the production was finished based on the sales on the website and the sales through eBay. Everything's going smoothly. Until I get a very nasty email from eBay. And the email was along the lines of, "Dear Mr. Kogan, we've noticed some irregular selling activity on your account. You have sold a high volume of products for which you are yet to receive feedback. We view your account as high risk. We have suspended your account. We will re-enable it when you receive feedback for these products." And I thought, damn, that's one of my sales channels shut down. I'm now really going to struggle to sell all of these TVs in time for when I need to pay the balance payment of 80% for this shipment. Then I got an even nastier email from PayPal, an eBay-owned company, pretty much saying the same thing, but that email ended with, "We have frozen the funds in your account. We will release the funds when you start receiving feedback for these items." So yeah, not a very nice email to receive. I was now in a position where I owed customers TVs. I'd paid a deposit to China, which isn't refundable. I have money locked up in a PayPal account, and I didn't have a method of generating enough sales in order to pay the balance payment to get the TVs from China. Basically up shit creek without a paddle. So I had to work out, well, how am I going to get out of this one? And luckily this is 2006, a time when banks were happy to give credit cards to every man and his dog. So I saw some credit card ads online and started applying. I then realized they all asked pretty much the same information. So I set up my Firefox browser, Chrome wasn't out at the time, set up my Firefox browser to auto fill out those forms. And you know, I had the process down to a T. I could apply for a new credit card in under a minute. So I'd click every single banner ad for a credit card, click, click, apply, 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 apply. Within a few days, an unemployed 23-year-old received about $50,000 worth of credit cards in the mail. Sweet. I was still about 15 grand short. So I called up a few mates and I was like, "Guys, I'm in a sticky situation here. It's really easy to get credit cards. Here's how you do it. Can you please do it for me?" Now, my mates had known me for a long time, so they knew that lending me money is as good as money in the bank. So they went and did it and got the credit cards approved as well. Took all of the credit cards, we went into the banks, took full cash advances on every single credit card, about 80 grand all up, and then paid the balance payment to China. Sent the money across to China, the balance payment for the order. Now, my balls were on the line. I owed heaps of friends money, I owed heaps of customers TVs, I owed heaps of banks money. I could not afford for a single thing to go wrong. I jumped on a flight and flew to Shenzhen. I arrived at the factory, gave them my business card, and then got them to show me the shipment, and I went and personally at the component level tested every single TV. Ensured that every component works, every input and output works, every function works, everything. The factory was a bit surprised. The guy that just gave them a founder and CEO card is down on all fours testing TVs. But at that point, I didn't really care what they thought. So I tested all of the TVs, they worked fine. I stood there and watched them loaded in the container. I then watched them seal the container. I then probably took it one step too far and I jumped in a taxi and paid the taxi driver to follow the container with me to the shipping yard. I've probably watched one too many movies. I have no idea what I was going to do if dudes with AKs jumped out to hijack the container. I had no ninja stars or anything. I did win Melbourne under 10 Kyokushin Karate Champion, but that was a while ago. So I have no idea what I was going to do, but luckily the container arrived at the shipping yard. Everything was fine. Got the cab to drive me back to my hotel, got all my stuff, went to the airport, flew back to Melbourne. That was the slowest 15 days of my life, sitting there waiting for the container to arrive. Every second took like 5 minutes. The container eventually got here. Put shipping labels on all of the TVs, sent them out to all of the customers. Customers received them. They were really happy with them. Started leaving feedback on eBay. The interwebs and all the forums and stuff were talking about Kogan and the TV and how much money they had just saved buying it. The feedback on eBay meant that eBay reopened my account. PayPal then unfroze the funds. And I was able to pay all of my friends back. I was able to pay all of the credit cards off, and I made a bit of profit as well. That profit meant that the next container didn't have to be a 45-day pre-sale. It was a 30-day pre-sale. The container after that wasn't a 30-day pre-sale, it was a 15-day pre-sale. The container after that, we started to have stock in the warehouse. Now Kogan is at the point 8 years on where we've never had a single cent of external funding. We have about 200 containers on the water at any given time, and we're turning over a few hundred million dollars. So everything's worked out pretty well. Now, there's a few lessons to be learned, or, you know, we wouldn't have enough time for me to stand here and talk about all the lessons learned from Kogan, but there's a few that I want to share with you. Got about 15 minutes. So the most important lesson in business and even in life is always look for win-win scenarios. That what's not sustainable cannot be sustained. You must create a win-win in every business relationship, in every client relationship, in everything. Now, you saw how with the factory and redoing all of their marketing material, I was able to create a win-win. Now, you sometimes have to think outside the box in order to create these. Any of you who went to Monash in Clayton will know that there's a lot of students and there's a massive car park. And no matter how massive they make the car park, there's never enough parking spots for all the students. Now, being the sort of student that I was at the time, I would rock up to lectures 5 to 10 minutes, not to lectures, I would rock up in my car to the uni 5 to 10 minutes after the lecture had started. And I'd pull up to the car park and then drive in, and I would circle around looking for a parking spot. Every now and then I would see someone pull out of their car spot a few aisles away. I'd zoom over there. By the time I got there, the spot was taken. I'd keep circling around like a headless chook, look at my watch, realize it's 25 minutes past the hour, too late anyway, think fuck it and drive home. Then I realized that it's actually very easy to get a parking spot. So by creating a win-win, so what I used to do is pull up to the entrance of the car park, next person walking in, I'd roll down the window, oh, excuse me, do you want a lift to your car? And they're always, sure. They hop in, drive them to their car, they pull out, I pull in. Win-win. Saves them a 200 or 300 meter walk, saves me driving around like a headless chook for half an hour. So an easy way to create a win-win. So you got to be creative about how you come up with them. I want to chat a little bit about social proof and the importance of it. I'm guessing a lot of you work in the digital space, and in my industry, it's all about online retail versus bricks and mortar. And the different business models have their different advantages. One area where bricks and mortar shits all over online retail is their ability for social proof. It's very hard to do online, and it's so, so important. Social proof is the reason why if you have two cafes next to each other, one might be empty, one might be full, and if you looked at them, you'd walk into the one with lots of people in it, even though the empty one might be cheaper and make better coffee. Social proof is extremely powerful. And I'll give you a couple of real life examples that I've seen about how powerful it is. I fly Melbourne to Sydney quite a lot. QF439, the flight I usually get from Sydney to Melbourne, gets into gate number 3 at Melbourne Airport. Now, on this particular day, I got a phone call just as we landed, and I was the first person off the plane. And it was an important phone call, so I was pretty involved in it. And usually from gate 3, you walk out, turn left, you're at baggage claim. And this particular day, I walk out, turn left, keep walking, it's an important phone call. Phone call ends, I look up, gate 12. Oh shit, got to turn around and walk back to baggage claim. So I turn around, what do I see? 200 people that followed me. Not a single person had bothered to use their own brain. Why use my own brain when I can use the guys in front of me? And then everybody applies that mentality, and that's the end result. A few years ago, I was in China and I saw some remote control helicopters, and it was finally when the assembly line for them enabled them to be really cheap. I was going to be able to import remote control helicopters, sell them for 19 bucks a pop. I thought, you know what, with this idea, let me try get a stand at a shopping center. And so I went to a popular shopping center and got a stand, and I got it from November 24th to December 24th, peak retail time, most expensive real estate. It got more expensive every single week. So the week 17th to the 24th is like through the roof. And these containers of helicopters arrive, I set up the stand, and I thought, oh, these are gonna sell like hotcakes. 19 bucks for a remote control helicopter, and this a few years ago as well, like awesome deal for a Christmas present. Set up the stand, first day, sell two or three helicopters. Second day, two or three helicopters. No one's buying them. I ordered two containers, 10,000 units of, and I'm thinking, shit, this is like 623 years worth of Christmas presents I got here. My cousin's high school was around the corner at the time, and he calls me up and he's like, Russ, I heard you've got remote control helicopters. I'm like, yeah. He's like, can I come at lunchtime with my mates and play with them? Sure, mate, come down. He comes down with his mates and they start playing with the remote control helicopters. All of a sudden, there's a stampede of people around the stall. I'm selling them like hotcakes. Transactions everywhere. Then lunchtime finishes, my cousin has to go back to school. Empty. Dead silent. I thought, all right. So I called my cousin up that evening. I'm like, mate, do you want 50 bucks a day to come and play with remote control helicopters every lunchtime? He's like, sure. 15-year-old kid's dream. So he kept rocking up every lunchtime and every weekend with his mates, and they were playing with the remote control helicopters. Each time they're there playing with them, huge crowds around the stall and they're selling like hotcakes. Ended up selling out by December 14th. The most expensive real estate that I had paid for, I had nothing to sell. That's the power of social proof. You know, you see sometimes in a shopping center, a massive crowd, and you're like, I wonder what's going on. And you walk up to it and you like, you have to push and shove to have a look. And it's some American guy cleaning a piece of carpet, and look how easy this is. Like, people will fight one another to watch a piece of carpet being cleaned. That's the power of social proof. And it's much more difficult to do online than with an in-store experience. And something to keep in mind with every web solution you work on. At Kogan, you'd notice that in the bottom left-hand corner on our desktop site, you'd notice a pop-up of live sales and what's going on and what's selling on the site. Just give people that additional comfort knowing others are purchasing from this store. When you're in a bricks and mortar store and see people lining up at the cash register, your brain's telling you, all right, other people have done their research, they're trusting this store. Other people have done their research, they're trusting the prices here. It's reassuring you to buy. If you're on a website you've never heard of before, you're thinking, am I the only one about to get screwed? You need to create social proof around your product and service online. Social media is one way to do it, but there's lots of other ways to do it as well. Round it up, all right. One final thing, PR. A lot of people say, oh, you get so much PR, like, what's the trick? no trick really, but probably I have to thank for Eminem and Ja Rule. Because when I grew up listening to a lot of rap, there was a time when Eminem and Ja Rule were battling. And Eminem would bust a few rhymes, then Ja Rule would reply, then Eminem, and they're dissing each other. And then one day Eminem puts out a reply saying, "I'm not replying anymore. I've sold you more records than you'd ever sell yourself. This is the end." And I, oh damn, like I was enjoying that. But it made me realize, I was like, that's so true. Many people would never have heard of Ja Rule until Eminem started creating songs, dissing him and replying to him. So then when Kogan was up and running, you all know who I was poking. And as part of that, you know, there was a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes. Like, I remember filming One Today Tonight story, and when the cameras were off, I was telling the journalists, I was like, oh, I wonder what Jerry thinks about this. Ooh, if you showed him this, he would not be happy. He would not be happy if you asked him for his comments on, you know, like the kid in high school trying to instigate a fight. Oh, you hear what he said about your mum? What did he say about your mum? Yeah. So I was trying to instigate that, and it worked. The Today Tonight journo went to Jerry Harvey. He was too stupid to do a no comment. Before you know it, he's on national TV, the most viewed show in Australia, with a printout of the Kogan website going, their prices aren't that much cheaper. Beauty. So yeah, thank you, Eminem. The key to PR, especially if you're a challenger brand, is a challenger brand needs an enemy. And your enemy must have two characteristics. It must be huge and it must be hated. The second one is usually achieved by the huge. So it's easy, like, you know, easy target, McDonald's, because they're huge. Everyone's like, oh, I'm making people fat. Like, McDonald's has never shoved a burger down anyone's throat. Nobody goes around talking like, McDonald's has served over 100 billion meals. I wonder how much they've driven prices down in the market in general. I wonder how many people were able to eat just because of McDonald's. You know, nobody says that, but everybody hates McDonald's. It's a safe enemy. So you need to have an enemy if you want to be a consumer champion and make sure they're big and they're hated. The other thing is now we're in the cycle of PR where a lot of journalists will like call me going, oh, I really want to know your opinion on this topic. And I'm like, sorry, I'm really busy right now. Then they'd call back again. It's like, oh, just give me a few minutes. Do you have a comment on this, this or this? And I'd give him a comment, and then the article's like, loudmouth punk entrepreneur always willing to share his opinion said. Who the fuck called who? So yeah, that's the quick Kogan PR thing. I don't know if we got any time for questions, but thank you very much. I only got like 12, 14 yawns out of that. So for a 9 a.m., I consider that decent. Thank you.
Thank you, Ruz. And sorry to have to wrap you up. I promised everybody that they'd be out of here by 10, and I want to leave time for a couple of questions if we got them. Interesting, in your own words, things ended pretty well. So I think it's a pretty good way to put it.
Oh, we're just getting started, so I can't, you know, and I'm ESL, English as a second language, so my adjectives aren't as good.
We've got a couple of quick questions for Ruslan. One here.
Great talk, thanks very much. Love your site and am a consumer of some of your product. I also think that we might be best friends because I get more emails from you than from anyone else. Is that because I bought your products? Because you are a statistics business. I mean, obviously you've got my details.
Yeah.
Does everyone who's purchased get the same amount of...
We do mix it up a bit, and we're constantly optimizing that strategy. You know, at the moment, it's not as awesome as we'd hope it would be. Some of the emails would be the same as other people. We send them because they work, but we are optimizing it. Personalization is a massive thing. Like, where we're going to end up in a few months is if you land on our site and we know you're a techie person, it'll say, 55-inch full HD, 1080p, 100Hz LED TV. If you're a not techie person, the title of the product will be Big Screen TV, perfect for action movies and sports. The more we personalize something, the better the conversion rates are going to be. We're not interested in annoying a person who's not interested in our products. Nobody wins. We want win-win.
Thanks. One more quick one, and then you can come hunt him down at the end.
Yeah. Look, you got to be on your A game. There have been a few little people come and try, and they've tried to do to us what we did to Jerry. And it's interesting because I'd get a phone call from a journalist and they'd be like, you know, we know every single person selling anything related to what we're selling in the market. We know their sales web, like I know them back to front. But when I'd get a call from a journalist like, have you heard of, and how was their entrance into the market and what's your view on that? And I'm like, who? I'm like, who? What? Oh, nah, never heard of them. Oh, they're one of your competitors. Nah, we monitor all of our competitors. Oh, how long have they? Nah, never heard of them. No idea what that name is. How do you say it? Oh, nah, no, okay, thanks, bye. That's the response. So, got to be on your A game.
Cool, all right, thank you very much, Ruslan. I appreciate your time this morning.
Thank you.